Who am I? I was born in Wayne, Nebraska, and grew up in Sioux City, Iowa. Was born into a football family, was getting tackled from the day I could walk, and was born into a trailer in Wayne, Nebraska, where my dad was playing college football for the Wayne State Wildcats. And sports has been a massive part of my life and who I am for a very long time, ever since I can really remember. Spent 5 years in the NFL, played for the Titans and the Browns, and spent a lot of that time on the training table when it was a dream come true and a lot of adversity. And after that, I traveled and kind of experienced the world, had some free time to explore, and found myself in Boulder, Colorado, involved in the agricultural world.
One of the things I didn't know in your football career was that you're undrafted free agent. There's only, I think, of 32 teams, there's only 30 undrafted free agents that made rosters that year. So, you know, less than one free agent per team.
I didn't know that.
Only approximately 30 free agents made rosters in 2004. The only other one besides you on your team was Walter Payton's son.
Yes.
Jared Payton. But you found out you made the NFL roster. Who was the first person you called, and what did you say?
Wow. I don't know if my memory can serve me that well. It was definitely my dad. Yeah. I know that. And what did I say? You know, it definitely, I know this, it wasn't overly excited, but it was almost, I think, relieved and still cautiously optimistic, because I knew what the competition was like out there. So I don't think I ever really allowed it to set in fully until I was actually, you know, stepping foot on the field, I guess. But it was my dad, and I think I just shared with him that it was real, because we had, you know, a number of conversations leading up to that point where I kept on making the cut. And it was definitely a powerful experience. Maintaining some sort of balance, because at that point the game and the thought of potentially getting cut and just attempting to perform at an extremely high level, it consumes you. It consumes your entire life. And I would say that just attempting to, you know, maintain some type of life, family, just personal health, personal growth through all of that, to kind of see the forest through the trees type of thing, I would say that's my biggest challenge. That was my biggest challenge. In it, what was my biggest challenge? Bigger, faster, stronger. You know, I could never stop. Just to kind of summarize what you just said about the NFL experience being this pinnacle, and it was, in a lot of ways, it was a dream come true, but when you start to get money involved into anything that was derived from a natural passion or desire to just be good at something or just immerse yourself in it, it changes things. It changes the dynamic with you and the sport, with you and your teammates. And so for me, and I was injured a lot in the NFL, so, you know, in some ways it was a pinnacle, in other ways it wasn't. You know, the high school and the college sports for me were much more passionate, and much the pride and the spirit, and not wanting to let the fans down or your parents down or your teammates down, was much more palpable at that level than it was at the professional level for me. The one big game at the high school level, I would say, was high school rival, you know, Sioux City Helan. It was a game, you know, my senior year, that was, touted as one of the biggest games in the rivalry. We were both, you know, really good throughout that year, and it was a battle, defensive battle throughout the whole game. And, Yeah, a couple big fourth downs, a couple big field goals, a couple big catches is kind of what made the difference. But it was, you know, you felt like you had the school on your shoulders type of thing. And you know, after the game, it's just one of those moments where the entire team is in the locker room, you know, literally left it all out on the field. And we're all singing our fight song, jumping up and down, looking at each other in the eyes. And, yeah, those moments stick with you forever. And yeah, it was powerful. Well, you're just asking me what one of my favorite college football moments was. And that just kind of, you know, leads into more of about our relationship and our story, because one of my favorite moments was against Southern Illinois when we had this incredible comeback, and Tyler, you and I are you know, safeties, you know, at the end of the game, Southern Illinois is attempting to, you know, march down the field to, you know, we're up, what, 1 point or 2 points at that point? I'm not sure. But we're up, and we've come back from an incredible comeback. I don't know, what was it, 30 points?
We've got 28.
28 points, yeah. And one of the most incredible comebacks I've ever experienced in my life. And just, you know, certain moments, just a lot of it's a haze. A lot of it's a blur. But the intensity of the game sticks with you, but there's those certain moments that are burned into your memory, and that was when you hit the receiver coming across the middle to, you know, get one of the final first downs of the game. Ball goes flying. I can still remember you out of the corner of my eye hitting this guy, and then just kind of letting it all go. Just every, you know, crowds going bananas. You know, you're in shock. I don't really think that you even knew what happened in the moment. Yeah, that was definitely one of my favorite college football experiences that I had. I went to college as a receiver. Yeah, I was the 4A State Player of the Year in Iowa, and, you know, the majority of my career was spent as a receiver and a safety. I played, you know, both ways. But I was recruited as more of a receiver, and I didn't redshirt, came in my first year as a freshman, and played receiver that entire year. Didn't get a ton of tick, but when Coach Mark Farley came into the picture, more of a defensive-minded guy, to say the least, and I guess he saw kind of the potential for me to switch over to be a defensive player and a safety, and that was a big decision. I remember being in tears when we went through that conversation, and you don't realize how attached you are to a certain position as a football player, but it's almost like asking somebody to play a completely different role that they don't necessarily know enough about at that level, even though I was completely confident at the high school level. But that was the first transition, and you know, at the end of the day, even though I resisted it then, playing on the defensive side of the ball for me was so much more gratifying, just because it allowed you to just be in your instincts, right? Just, you know, reacting, you know, instinctually to what was happening in front of you. You know, still to this day, I get it through Ultimate Frisbee, but just, you know, that instantaneous reaction in the moment to what's unfolding versus a scripted play. Like I really, really enjoyed. So then played safety my sophomore year. Going into the junior year, we had a shakeup in the backfield, the defensive backfield, and we were, you know, short, you know, some talent at corner. And they asked me, I don't know if they asked me as much as they told me that that's where I was going to play, but you know, they gave me a choice, basically, you know, to play corner or you know, potentially leave the team. And I had some very real conversations with my dad about potentially transferring at that point. I've never played corner in my life, and now, you know, I'm being asked to play defense corner, which I think is one of the hardest positions on the field, and compete against some of the most talented athletes. You know, it's 1AA football, but I mean, we have some, you know, high caliber athletes who make the NFL. And yeah, that was a huge decision. A lot of fear. A lot of fear of, am I going to be good enough to be successful at this position that I've never played before? And at the end of the day, I stayed. I committed to learning corner and figuring that out. And yeah, it was not always pretty. It was definitely rocky at the beginning, and you know, learned a ton from my teammates. A lot of help. You know, very kind of cohesive group of defensive teammates, including yourself. And yeah, I ended up first team all conference corner at the end of that season. And
if they told you when they asked you to switch corner, you think you could be a first team all conference corner, what would you have believed that?
No way.
At that moment,
I wouldn't have allowed myself to believe it, because I knew that that would probably inhibit me from being that, right? I mean, I think that's a big part of it. I was never that kind of player who had incredible, you know, confidence outwardly, but yeah, because I didn't think it served me necessarily. I always thought, hey, I have somewhere to improve, right? But that year, I would say, I proved a lot to myself, you know, achieving first team all conference as a corner, and going up against Oklahoma State and some of these, like, yeah, monster receivers.
Deshaun Woods,
first round draft pick. Yeah, that was a heck of an experience. And then transferred back to safety my senior year, which you know, it's probably my most natural position. That's what I played, you know, in the NFL. But yeah, I would say that junior season where I played corner was pretty transformational. Taught me a lot.
That is,
for me, when I think about self-awareness, I just think about being honest with ourselves as much as possible, and who we are, what we're good at, and what we're not, and sharing that openly, so that you are not getting yourself in a position where you've said you can do something and you can't fulfill on that. And so I just think self-awareness is just, is honesty. And when we're talking about, you know, where do we focus on, you know, the strengths or the weaknesses, you know, your strength is your weakness and your weakness is your strength type of thing. And, you know, we could run around in circles all day mentally with this, but you know, if your strength is that you're big and strong, well, you know, typically that's going to mean that you're not necessarily, you know, fast and athletic, right? I mean, you know, there's give and a take basically with all these strengths and weaknesses. And I just think that the more you can stop comparing yourself to somebody else, then the more honest with yourself that you can be, and then put yourself in a position to, you know, be empowered for whatever you're trying to accomplish, and not say, oh, I wish I was this other person, I wish I had this other skill set. No, let's appreciate that person's skill set and appreciate our own for what we are, and then we can work together, hopefully, to accomplish this bigger task. I'll talk about a little bit about leaving football behind, because yeah, that's another life-shaping moment. So, you know, I had a five-year career. Most of that was spent either on the practice squad or the training table. Broke both of my feet my first season as a professional football player, and then I proceeded to have four additional knee surgeries, which eventually, you know, put me out of football for good. So, you know, again, when people, you know, have the perspective that, you know, you made the NFL, like, how amazing. I agree, you know, but it took me a long time to get there, because my experience in the NFL was not at all a successful story while I was there to myself, as far as accelerating, you know, as an athlete at that level. So I think it just drove me to, you know, because I didn't give myself really any other options. So it was like, I'm either, you know, going to be successful at this, or there's There's nothing. I didn't, you know, have a job that I was thinking about or a career or that I, you know, was really passionate about. I mean, my life was football at that point.
There's a lot of, sometimes there's a lot of power in not having a plan B.
But exactly. Yeah, yeah. I mean, when you don't think that you have any other option, then I think you're just much more driven to just get up every day and just do that one thing, because that's all you've given yourself the opportunity to do. And I, you know, I talk to people about, they ask me, how did you make it to the NFL? And I always say, there's a fine line between, you know, self-motivation to do something and fear of failure. And I think I went back and forth between, you know, the two of those a lot.
Sure.
Right? So anyways, it was a very tough decision. Nobody's actually telling you when and where you are supposed to retire. So this is a decision that you have to make yourself, and to make that decision when you've never given yourself any other option is one of the hardest things that you've ever done, because you don't know who you are in a lot of ways, you know, when you're not a football player. And you go from somebody who's looked highly upon by everybody 1 second to when you decide to retire, you become a has-been, and what happened, why aren't you not playing, you know, why didn't it work out type of questions. So I think, you know, that's difficult to kind of, you know, chew off and process when it's coming at you all at once. Yeah, when and where that quote came into my life, I can't pinpoint it. I mean, I have to give a lot of credit to my parents and my coaches, and just kind of, I guess, the Midwest attitude, I think, is, you know, pretty humble in that way. So where it came from, obviously from my upbringing at some point. And, you know, I think it serves you when you do not look at yourself as better than anybody else, even though your current experience may feel like it's better than, you know, other people's experience at that point. But, you know, having, you know, trying to maintain some sense of humility, you know, along this ride, because, you know, we're all going through, you know, ups and downs, you know, just at, you know, different levels of reality, but, you know, we're all going through the same roller coaster ride. So I think maintaining some sense of, hey, you know, we're all going through the same things, and, you know, the people that we choose to surround ourselves with, they should see us in all of those ups and downs, not just, you know, you just don't want to surround yourself with the people who are attracted to you at the top. You want to surround yourself with the people who are attracted to you at the bottom, because those are the people who are going to support you in your darkest hours.
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, I've been on this concept recently of vessel dynamics, and that's where the sign came from. But, you know, I think that, you know, team sports, I don't think a lot of people get the experience of training in team sports for an extended period of time. I think a lot of people, you know, look back on their, you know, high school, you know, days, and you know, that's where they've experienced team sports. But, you know, beyond that, as you kind of mature into adulthood, you know, I don't think people get to experience, you know, that so often. So I feel like the feeling of working with a large group of people with one common goal, everybody knowing their individual role, like Tyler, for example, what's your skill set? Well, you know, Tyler is a guy who can, you know, run the defense, manage the defense, a great cover guy. Okay, well, let's not put Tyler in a position where he's not going to be able to excel, and not look at his weaknesses, but look at somebody's strengths and then put them in a position to be able to execute based on those strengths. And then we can all work off one another. And I think, you know, as an entrepreneur, I think I've always kind of looked at, you know, teams and you know, attempting to accomplish a goal with that lens.
Yeah. Now,
I think at the end of the day, when you boil it down, to acknowledge the fact that there's wins and losses, there's peaks and valleys, there's ups and downs, strikes and gutters, this mentality of understanding that happiness comes with unhappiness, that we have to understand that it's not always going to feel amazing. It's not always going to feel like, you know, we're on top of the world, but having acceptance of some the harder times, and realizing that those hard times are are what going is what's going to make you really appreciate the good times, and in those hard times, almost looking forward to them in some ways, because you know those are the times that are truly going to shape and sharpen you as a person.
Sure.
And the more, and I just look, I wake up and I have bad days. I have bad moments, right? And I don't think it ever goes away. I just think it's a moment-to-moment practice. And yeah, I think that's just trying your best is all you can do. I guess, you know, beyond sports, but I guess it's applicable to sports. It's relationships. I mean, sports, in life, I think all boils down to our relationships and, you know, like I said, being there for people, doing what you say, saying what you do, you know, as much as possible, and really, you know, appreciating and cultivating, you know, those throughout your lifetime, and surrounding yourself with people that you respect, because I do believe that you are the culmination of the five people you spend the most time with, right? And so if you believe that, I would say, you know, look, you know, why are you, you know, and I had great friends growing up, but I think I would still, you know, ask myself, like, what are you giving to this, you know, potential relationship? What are you receiving from this relationship? And how does that affect you in your pursuit of any goals that you may have?
Sure.
Right? And if I would ask myself that question more so than not, I think I would be in a not a better position, but I think it would have benefited me in some way. I think it starts with the home base. It starts with the personal headquarters, right? I mean, if you want to elevate somebody else, I think that you have to be in a position where, you know, you are feeling elevated yourself. And I think that just naturally rubs off through osmosis versus actually, you know, telling people how to become elevated a lot of times. Like, I've always kind of found myself in more of a lead by example, not necessarily, you know, speaking it, even though I think that there's certain people with that amazing ability and gift to motivate people with their voice.
Right.
I wasn't that guy. Sure. So I, you know, my, I guess, elevation technique just came from taking care of myself, you know, taking pride in what I was doing, and hopefully that rubbed off, you know, through to my teammates. So I think that the other thing is not focusing on the weaknesses of somebody else. You know, how do you elevate somebody else? Well, not being critical of, you know, when they fall down and make a mistake, because,
right,
you know, you're going to have that same thing happen to you. And if we start this pattern of being critical to one another, well, the team dynamic goes away. You know, that person needs to know that I'm going to be there for them when they fall down, and vice versa. And I think that's how we all kind of elevate each other. It's not just going to come from one person. It has to come from everybody. I would say, I have a ton of respect for all of my coaches, because that is not an easy job. And I learned something from all of them, and I think I'm a better person from almost every coach that I've ever had. I would say, just because of where I was at the age of my life, and just kind of overall life impact, I would say my high school football coach, Walt Fiegel, was probably the number one as I look back on my career. And I say that because, you know, when you're in high school, you're definitely searching and trying to discover who you are and you know, what's your place on the team and in life and all of that. What group am I going to hang out with? Am I the jock or the, you know, the math guy or whoever? And I think that, you know, Walt, he was able to plug into that and give us some very concrete life advice through football. And he was, I don't even know how old he was, but I remember thinking that, wow, this guy's really old for a coach right now. You know, and he used to drive around in his golf cart. And you know, the things I remember is his passion, and he was just lit up all the time, even though he was an older guy. And I remember respecting him. It just seemed like he was enjoying life, even though I didn't think that he even, you know, knew that we needed to punt every time when it was fourth down. You know, I just think that he had this passion for life. He had this ability of you know, teaching us life lessons through the game. And he cared. He felt like he actually cared about you more so off the field than on the field in a lot of ways. And I think, you know, tough times don't last, tough people do. That's one of the quotes that I think has always, you know, stuck with me throughout time, and that came from Walt. And he was an amazing guy. I think it's, what is your definition of success? And ask yourself, does your definition of success go beyond just sports? Because that definition, in my mind, is going to make you better at sports.
Taylor!
Whoa, what? Yeah.
Let's get out of here.
You know what? I'm over it.